My name is Jerry Gill. Today is September 1, 2010. I'm visiting with Russell Pierson here in the State Fairgrounds in Oklahoma City. This interview is for the Oklahoma State Storage Project of the Oklahoma Oral History Research Program. Russell, I appreciate you taking time away from your business today to visit with us.
Well, that's my pleasure.
Could we back up kind of, you've got a long history with Oklahoma State University. We want to talk about that, but I'd like to back up for a minute and talk about your early life, where you grew up, your family. Can you share some of that information? Where did you grow up, Russell?
On a farm 3 miles north of Mangum down in Greer County.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What, did you go to high school in Mangum?
Yes, first of all, I went to a little one-room country school. My mother started me in school when I was 4 years old. And then she held me back a grade so I'd be with my cousins who were grade behind me. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the time, Mangum School until I went to Oklahoma A&M.
Okay. Well, did you have any community activities or high school activities you were involved in? Were you in sports or?
In high school?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Well, of course, like most country kids, I was pretty active in sports. Mm-hmm. I played at left end on the football team at Mangum in the junior and senior year. I was pretty vicious. I was, I know the tackles that opposed me were scared because I weighed 135 pounds. But I was pretty fast on my feet and I could sort of get out of their way. Then on defense, I played halfback. That's what they called it then, defensive halfback, because I could jump pretty high and knock down passes or intercept them, whatever the case might be. And I was on the track team. That was my main sport, was track.
What, were you a sprinter or a distance runner?
No, I ran everything you needed to run, but mainly I was a distance runner. Mm-hmm. Especially the half mile and the mile. We didn't have the 2 mile back in those days in the high school. I guess I won my share of them.
Well, Russell, were you in 4-H or FFA?
4-H.
Mm-hmm. You had...
Oh, I had a good county agent. I never did really set the world on fire, but I was active enough that he was out at our farm quite a little bit.
Did you show?
His name was Roy Georgia, mm-hmm. as did most country boys. And Dad would usually give us an acre to 10 acres of cotton that was ours when we sold it. And... actually, soil conservation, I guess, in 4-H was my main activity. We ran a lot of terrace lines on farms around Greer County.
Well, Russell, was your family, you know, your parents, were they the first people to farm that after it was opened for settlement?
Yeah, my grandfather settled on, well, they brought a little wagon train in, about 8 or 10 wagons. From down in Eastland County, Texas, and settled there on Elm River, north of Mangum. And that was, of course, he, like all country boys, he was, back in those days, involved in cattle. He got in on one pretty good size cattle drive as a cowboy. After that, he was a farmer.
What are some values and principles you learned growing up on the farm and with your family?
Well, we got a long history in the Baptist church at Mangum. My grandfather and mother and grandmother were charter members of the First Baptist Church at Mangum, and we were church people. Sometimes we didn't get to go to church because we lived out in the country, and if it was raining, well, you didn't go.
I guess you learned about hard work and discipline working out on the farm.
I know what it is to have blisters on my hands, yes.
Did you have, how many acres was your, a quarter section or larger?
Well, we owned, actually, when my parents got married, they bought 80 acres that my great-grandmother had settled on. And... then we always worked some rented land too to fill it out. We generally were operating 160 to 200 acres.
Okay. What you're talking about Oklahoma A&M earlier, what influenced you to go to school at Oklahoma A&M? I mean, that's a long ways from Mangum to Stillwater.
It is, especially if you're hitchhiking.
Yes, sir.
Which was our mode of travel. Well, I'll tell you why, if we got time, I don't know how much time you want to use on this, but the year I graduated from high school, I'd been pretty active in athletics, especially in track, and I also was on the glee club and quartet. I sang bass on the quartet high school. Coming home, Dad and I had been to town with a load of something, and I don't remember what it was. And coming back, he said, "Son," we were in a wagon, farm wagon. He said, I know you want to be an athletic coach. You're going to go up to A&M here in a couple of weeks. But he said, if I had my choice, I'd like to see you training to be what Mr. Georgia is. Well, Mr. Georgia was our county agent. No, I said, no, I want to be an athletic coach. Well, I went up to A&M and I enrolled in science and literature with physical education as a major. And I stayed with that about 2 weeks. What my dad had told me, just kept ringing in my ear, "Son, I'd like to see you be what Mr. Georgia is. You'd still be working with the boys, but you'd give us farmers a lot of help." So 2 weeks after I enrolled up there, I switched majors and went over to agriculture. Mm-hmm. I've never been regretful of it. That was good advice my father gave me.
What year was that? Do you recall that you enrolled?
1929. September 1929.
Okay. Was your work with 4-H and being farmed, was that your sort of your influence to go to Oklahoma State University, or was there somebody that encouraged you to go to Oklahoma A&M?
Well, that encouraged me some, yes. But I was so predominant in, especially in track in high school, that I had my mind made up to be an athletic coach.
Okay.
But I guess you don't take the country out of a country boy.
Where did you live on campus?
Room 204 Hanner Hall.
Hanner Hall.
It was a brand new hall. Mm-hmm. Real nice. In fact, it was a very convenient spot. I was right across the hall from the bathroom.
That's good. Do you remember your roommate?
My first roommate was a boy from Mangum. Name was Winter McReynolds. Mm-hmm. And then later on, a boy from over in eastern Oklahoma at Boynton, John Crouch, was my roommate. And he was also my best man at my wedding.
Okay. You were talking about earlier, you had to hitchhike to get home. Did you get to go home very often?
No, you didn't, because after my sophomore year, I had to lay out one semester because I didn't have money enough to get back up there and enroll. But I got a job with the agronomy department because that's where I was going to major, and what was your question? I lost it.
Just asking about you going home for vacation.
Oh, yeah.
Did you get a chance to go home very often?
No, we didn't, because we had to hitchhike. You didn't have money enough to ride the bus. So we hitchhiked. Sometimes it took us a little better than a day to get there.
Wow.
From Stillwater to Mangum. But coming back was pretty good, because we could catch what we call the film truck that delivered film every night to the county seats along between Oklahoma City and Mangum. And we'd catch him about midnight and ride back to Oklahoma City and then hitchhike on to Stillwater next day. That was usually our route.
Kind of, we're talking about in the fall of 1929, is that when you said you enrolled?
I enrolled, first of all, in the fall of 29.
Okay. What was the campus like in 1929? What buildings do you remember? Could you describe what the campus was like?
Well, they had quite a few buildings. Well, to a country boy like me, they had a lot of buildings. Mm-hmm. But They had the Morrill Hall and Hanner Hall and the old Crutchfield Hall, which was a boys' dormitory. They had the Animal Science Building and the Dairy Building, Whitehurst Hall, Jesse Thatcher Hall, which was where the girls stayed, and Gardner Hall, which was a girl dormitory too. And the auditorium, and Old Central, of course, land sakes, yes, Old Central. That's about it. Engineering building.
Russell, where were most of your, what buildings were most of your classes held in?
Whitehurst Hall, most of them. And we had one class in the Dairy Building, and I had two or three classes over in the Animal Husbandry Building.
So most of your classes were in Whitehurst Hall?
Most of them were in Whitehurst Hall.
Interesting, which is now the administration building, with back then its classes. Yeah. Hmm. What do you remember about Theta Pond? What was Theta Pond like then? Is anything like it looks like today?
Yeah, Theta Pond was in existence. It was kind of a lover's place, which I didn't get to go to very much. Until 1933, when the time came for elect the royalty of the Department of Agriculture. A bunch of us old kids that couldn't afford to belong to a fraternity got together and decided we were going to run a candidate for Aggie Princess, which was the same as Aggie Queen. We did. Our chief competition was the girl that worked in the Dean of Agriculture's office, a student. In those days, the professors could vote on the Aggie Princess the same as the students, which most of them did, and you know where the vote was cast. But we won for 5 votes. Close race.
Close race, yes, sir.
So my blonde-headed girl, who was the candidate, Bernice Strom, was the Aggie Queen or Aggie Princess, whichever you wish to call it, in 1933. So after that, we visited Theta Pond occasionally, yes.
Well, now, I got to get the rest of the story. Did you know Bernice before before you run her for queen? And had you
well, yeah, I knew her before. I didn't know her before she started school. I was a junior when she started school in the fall of 32. And she was from a wheat and cattle farm over near Perry. So we had some things in common, and besides that, she was a beautiful blue-eyed blonde. I wouldn't say it was love at first sight, but boy, it sure was attraction at first sight.
That's good. That's good.
And romance developed after that. We had 3 years of romance before we got married. Her daddy had told her, said, now, girls your age sometimes get married kind of early. Said, if I send you to A&M, you got to promise to teach school 2 years before you get married. So she did. She got a one-room schoolhouse 5 miles from her home, and she taught school 2 years. School was out on Friday, and there was a wedding on Sunday.
That's good. Well, what do you recall? See, Dr. Bennett, President Henry G. Bennett.
Yeah, Henry G. Bennett.
He's just been there about a year. What do you remember about Dr. Bennett?
I remember that he was a very considerate, concerned individual. He really had the students' interests at heart. I didn't get too personally well acquainted with him, though he knew my name, which I appreciated. But to everybody, he was Dr. Bennett. And Dr. Bennett was in charge of the school. We all respected him and loved him.
Now, you said your background was Baptist, growing up in Mangum. And Dr. Bennett was—he taught Sunday school class.
He was a Baptist too.
Baptist. Did you ever attend any one of his Sunday school classes?
I never was in his class in Sunday school. He taught Sunday school some.
Well, who was the dean of the College of Agriculture at that time?
What's that?
You remember the dean of the College of Agriculture?
Carl Blackwell.
For whom Lake Carl Blackwell was named after.
Yeah, the man that the lake is named after. Yeah, he was a good dean.
What do you remember about Dean Blackwell.
I remember that if you wanted an audience with Dr. Blackwell, you could get it. Mm-hmm. He was concerned about the ag students.
What, kind of speaking of you're going from dean to, you know, president to dean to professors, do you remember some of the professors you had that were influential in your development?
Oh, yes. There was more than one. I. W. Staten was the principal one that I think was influenced. He was coach of the cross judging team.
And what was his name again?
High W. Staten.
Oh, High Staten.
Yeah.
Okay. S-T-A-T-O-N, Staten.
Yeah, he was a professor in the agronomy department, which we called field crops and soils at that time. And he was our coach on the cross judging team. We were fairly successful. I was on the team. In fact, placed as fourth high individual in the national contest, which was held in Chicago. And we had second, fourth, and sixth place individuals, yet our team score only brought us in second.
Wow.
Nebraska beat us 10 points out of a total of 3,600 points.
Wow.
But we were pleased.
Yeah, that's great.
Other professors you asked about would be Dr. L.L. Ligon, who was in charge of the cotton research, and I worked for him. And
Dr. Higgin?
Huh?
Did you say Dr. Higgin?
Dr. Ligon, L.L. Ligon.
Ligon.
And by the way, with the entomology, Hickson was another real good professor, as was Dr. Kraft, who was a genetics prof over in the Alma Husbandry building.
Do you remember who the dean of men was at that time?
What?
Who was the dean of men while you were in school?
McElroy.
Oh, Dean Mack.
Yeah, Dean Mack.
Mm-hmm. Did you get to know Dean Mack?
Not personally, because I behaved myself.
You called on the carpet. Huh?
Some of the boys got pretty well acquainted with him. But Dean Mack was a fine guy.
Russell, can you share some highlights of time you were a student at Oklahoma State? For example, you talked about track. You ran track at Oklahoma State, is that right?
Yes. I made the cross-country team, and I made the track team as a distance runner. In those days, the cross-country was 5 miles. If it can be said without any boasting, as a freshman, I outran the entire varsity except the number one man. And as a result of that, the varsity team said, "Russell, there's a run over at Tulsa that you ought to go to." Oh, I said, "I'm not up to that." Oh, they said, "We think you can win it." So I caught a bus and went over to Tulsa, to the Tulsa Run. They called it the 5 Mile Marathon. I was a country kid. I was scared to death because that was a big event. Well, my plan was, I'm gonna make a pretty fast first mile, see how many follow me. So I hit up a pretty good lick in the first mile, and there were a few there with me, but I just kept up the pace. I got the Loving Cup.
For first place.
First place, yeah.
And were freshmen eligible to run the
varsity? Freshmen could not run on the varsity.
Okay.
You had a freshman team of your own. Well, to finish more of what you asked me, the freshmen did get to compete in the conference. We were in the Missouri Valley Conference, and they had what they called the telegraphic meet. Coach would pick a day, and everything had to be done on that day. Well, the final result was in the Missouri Valley Freshman Conference meet, I came in second in the half mile, second in the mile, and out in front on the 2 mile. I won the 2 mile.
Freshman is pretty good.
Yeah, but I was only competing against freshmen.
Yeah, freshmen, okay. Who was Russell?
And I won a few varsity, but I finished in the quote, also ran, unquote, in a good many of the races too, out of the money.
When you're doing your varsity years, who was some of your main competition in those years?
In the varsity? Well, the top man, his name was Alan Jenkins. He was good. He won the 2 mile and the Drake relays and some of the other big meets. Brian Thompson was the captain of the cross country team the year I was a sophomore, and we won the Missouri Valley that year.
Who were your main
competitors? A boy named Taylor Lane, who finally became a highway patrolman here in Oklahoma. And a boy from Kansas, Bill Medder, who's also on the cross-country team.
Who were some of the other schools that you competed against that were your main competition?
You made in the conference?
In the conference and just otherwise?
Well, Drake was one. Creighton. Oh boy. Grinnell in Iowa. Those are the main ones.
You ever compete against the University of Oklahoma?
They were not in the conference. I'm glad you mentioned that. Because one of my braggadocios, which sounds a lot bigger than it actually is, in all the time I ran on the A&M track team, there was only one Sooner that ever beat me. And he went to the Olympics. His name was Glenn Dawson. The name will be familiar to quite a few people. He went to the Olympics on the U.S. team in the 3,000-meter steeplechase. I think he came in fourth just out of the medals. But he was, I like to brag it, there never was a Sooner that beat me at the 2 mile, except Glenn Dawson. But he beat me so far that I didn't even feel his dust.
What about other student activities? You said you were on the crop judging team and competed nationally in the track. Were you involved in any other student organizations or activities?
Yeah, in this Aggie Society. I finally became vice president of the Aggie Society.
What about academic achievements? You did pretty good in the classroom?
Well, as a freshman, I wasn't too hot because this country kid wasn't accustomed to that kind of instruction, but I came in with a lot of A's as a junior and a senior. I did reasonably well.
What were some favorite student hangouts on campus and off campus at that time?
Well, there were two, and I didn't have money enough to go to either one of them. Swims over just across from Gardner Hall was the main one. I'd go in there once in a while and get a malt. And the other was the Aggie Corner up there, across from where the fire station is now.
Oh, right there in the corner of Knobloch and
yeah,
College Avenue.
Yeah, Knobloch.
Okay. Were there, some popular student activities? What were the popular things to do, and what did students do on campus?
Well, they had the thing called a Student Senate Dance, which actually was held downtown. It was one that some of us poor boys could go to because you only paid, I think, a dime to get in if you were a letterman. Athletes, we got in free except for, I guess it was a tax that we had to pay. And then Swim's Corner was a very common meeting place for people.
Well, did they still have the tradition of the freshman beanies?
In those did days? They what?
The freshman beanies?
Yes, sir, and you better have yours on.
Well, what happened if you didn't?
There was a paddle about that long.
Oh, mercy. So you had now, what were the rules? You had to have it, anytime you're on campus, you were walking around campus, you had to be wearing your beanie.
Yes, sir. In that freshman year, you better have that beanie on.
Were there some other class traditions? I mean, like, used to classes competed against each other. Were they still doing that in your time? Like the freshman class would compete against the junior class, or the ag college would compete against the
no,
engineering college?
No, I don't remember anything of that.
Okay. Was ROTC pretty big at that time?
Was what?
ROTC.
Yeah, we all were in it for the first 2 years were college. We all took ROTC, unless you had a medical discharge. I wasn't too enthused over it, but after all, they provided you some clothes to wear.
Were there dorm hours for the women? They had to be
at
a certain time?
Yeah, I don't remember what they were. Of course, until I got to be a junior, I didn't have enough nickels and dimes to be interested in going over to the girls' dormitories.
What sports were popular on campus?
Oh, football was the big deal.
Who was the coach then? You remember the football coach?
The very famous Lynn Waldorf. Yeah, yeah, he was a good coach. And he was a nice guy. I remember one track meet that we went to when there weren't enough rides, enough vehicles to carry the track team. Lynn Waldorf volunteered to take us boys to that track meet somewhere up in Iowa, I think it was. He was a nice guy. He was just as nice to us track boys as he was to the football players. So we thought a lot of Lynn Waldorf. Puny James was the freshman coach. Honestly, I don't remember who was the basketball coach now. It wasn't Hank Iba.
Coach Iba hadn't gotten there yet.
No. Okay. Roy Kenny was the track coach.
Well, what about wrestling? Did you become a wrestling fan when you were at OSU?
I didn't try to wrestle, but we had a good wrestling team.
Did you attend wrestling matches?
Yeah, we got to go in and get in free. Mm-hmm. So
students got in free?
Yeah. If you were a letterman, you got in and everything free.
Oh, okay. Well, now they were wrestling in the old gym. Gym. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which has then since become was what the armory for OCC, and now it's the architecture building, but the old gym. I understand that's pretty packed and a lot of students in there?
Yes, sir. It was well packed. Mm-hmm. It wasn't very large.
Russell, how did you, I guess within about the first year you got there, we had the stock market crash and then the depression. How did that affect students financially?
Well, I can tell that from personal experience. While I was still in high school, there was a man came down, he was kind of what you'd call shirt-tailed kinfolks, three or four generations removed. He was at Mangum, and he said, "Russell, if you'll come to A&M, I'll give you a job in my cafe." So that's the way I ate the first year and a half. I was at A&M. I had the sorriest job in the cafe. I cleaned up at night, washed the pots and pans, and scrubbed the floor. But gee whiz, I was sure glad to get that job, because that kept me fed. Mm-hmm. Then those hard times hit, and his business went down, and I lived on pretty slim rations in the last semester as a sophomore. To be exact, I kept a box of dry cereal in the window in my dormitory, and a bowl and a spoon and a little packet of sugar. And that was my breakfast. I put a little water on that.
Water?
I put a little water on that cereal to moisten it and sprinkle a little sugar on it. That's what I had for breakfast. You could get an apple for a nickel. So that was my lunch. And I could get a sandwich over in the cafeteria for 15 cents, and that was my supper. So you know about how much strength I had for running on that kind of a ration. So the next semester I didn't get, I just couldn't get back in school. And I called the dean of the head of the Field Crop and Soils Department, Dr. Winters, and asked him if he could supply me with a job enough that I could batch and have some meals. Well, he said, why don't you come up here and we'll talk about it. So I hitchhiked up to Stillwater, that was in November, and met with Dr. Winters. He said, yeah, Russell, we'll give you a job working in the laboratory here for $20 a month. Oh man, that sounded like $1 million to me. So I came back up and enrolled, and there were four of us boys worked in that department. And two or three weeks after the school started, Dr. Winters called us in and said, fellas, I'm sorry, our funds are getting low. All we're going to be able to let you make is $15 a month. So we did. That lasted maybe 2 months. He called us in again, and said, well, finances are tough. $12.50 a month. $12.50 a month is all we're going to be able to pay you. So we just kept working like we always had. We got by on it.
Russell, was this your third year in school?
That would have been my third year. Third year.
Do you remember where the cafe was located, where you worked?
Yeah. It was located right next to Hanner Hall. At the top, I believe it was part cafe, cafeteria, and part, I think the Army, armory had a piece of it for storage.
Well, Russell, as you look back at your time at Oklahoma State University, what were some of your favorite memories of your time on campus? Do you have some favorite?
Yeah, I think
especially being things that stand out in your mind.
I think the most valuable memory that I have was coming in from the field. I worked in the summertime out on the experiment station. Coming in at noon and having lunch at a place that kept girls during the school semester. So second week of September, us boys came in there to eat lunch, and there was a whole parlor full of girls. And there was one I get a little emotional when I get to this point. There was one little blue-eyed blonde that, boy, she caught my eye. I was very careful that when the house mother called us to lunch that she was going to sit by me. So I pulled her chair out and seated her, and then I sat down by her. Later on, she told me that's the first time a boy had ever seated her anywhere. So I guess I made a little bit of an impression.
Being a gentleman pays off, Russell. That's good.
And then 3 years later, we began 67 years of married life.
Russell, as we talked earlier before we started the interview, you actually got your first job before you graduated. Is that right? Could you talk about your first job you had after school?
First job I had after school, well, one day I had hitchhiked home for Christmas and then hitchhiked back to work a few days in the laboratory. And Mr. Staten, crop judging coach, came in where I was working and said, Russell, would you like to go out as an assistant county agent? I said, when? He said, now. Well, I said, Mr. Hayden, I don't have a degree. He said, I don't think it's going to make any difference. He said, they're needing boys out there to help these county agents because they've got this new government farm program that President Roosevelt has installed, and the county agents are covered up. They need some help. Well, I said, I'd be willing to take a look at it, I guess. if they don't care about the degree, but I don't have one. Well, he said, let me talk to the district agent. So he did, and sure enough, that afternoon, the district agent called me and asked me to meet him, so I did, and we agreed. He sent me down to Hollis as assistant county agent. $135 a month. Boy, that was big money, even if I did have to furnish my own transportation, my own car. So I went down there and worked with Uncle Tom Marks, the oldest county agent in Oklahoma. I was there for 2 years, and then the district agent, I had asked him, Mr. Dale, when are you going to have a county for me? And he had told me, he said, the right one for you hasn't come along. So one day he called me and said, Russell, that county that you ought to have is available now. Meet me over at Paul's Valley on such and such a date, and we're going to meet with the county commissioners. So I did. They had another guy already picked out for the job, but they gave it to me.
This is Garvin County.
Garvin County, one of the good, yeah, you'd agree with that. Being a Garvin County native.
That's right.
One of the, but honestly, it was one of the good counties of Oklahoma.
Yes. Well, Russell, can you kind of talk about the rest of your career in agricultural extension? So you were, how long were you in Paul's Valley?
I was county extension agent there for 11 years. And during 7 of those years, we won the state championship in crops judging. We had some grand champions in the livestock exhibition. I had a good bunch of 4-H club kids and a good bunch of mothers and fathers. Because these mothers and fathers are influential in seeing that the kid does his work. And we had some good kids.
Did you have any kids from Lindsay? They were any good?
Yes, sir. One of my top boys was down south of Lindsay, Ray Duncan. Also had Beverly Parr, Tennis Parr.
Tennis Parr.
Didn't have Beverly. Beverly was his dad. I had Tennis Parr as a 4-H club kid.
So where did your career take you after that? You were, what, about 11 years then in the so
well,
then, ag extension?
The head of the Department of Field Crops and Soils Department called me and said, would you be interested in taking over the crops, Oklahoma Crop Improvement Association work? Well, I had developed several certified seed growers, particularly of corn. So I went up there and we talked about it, and I took the job. I was head of the Oklahoma Crop Improvement Association for 7 years.
Now, was this still part of the Extension Service, or was it?
Actually, I was a joint employee between the Experiment Station and the Extension Service.
Okay.
Because the two together were the authority of the Oklahoma of seed certification in Oklahoma, which was my job. I walked a lot of fields.
Which crops were you mostly? Did you mostly work with?
Well, of course, at that time the big crop was wheat, but we also had quite an alfalfa seed program. Oh yeah, and grain sorghums, of course, and one that I doubt is still in existence: watermelons. Georgia had always had the watermelon seed business. But we started growing certified black diamond watermelons in Oklahoma, and that's one time we had better than 2,000 acres of them that we had to inspect. I enjoyed it. Of course, walking those sand hills wasn't too easy, but it's still all right.
You're responsible for the entire state of Oklahoma?
The state of Oklahoma, that's as far as we went. We had plenty. It's mostly in the western half of the state. But we did have quite a lot of wheat growers in the panhandle where we encountered a few rattlesnakes.
Be careful where you pick your cotton, huh? Well, you then your career took a turn after that.
What's that?
Said your career took a major turn after you finished that program, right?
Well,
and you went to.
I got well acquainted with the seed industry as head of the Crop Improvement Association. Yeah, in fact, I got pretty well acquainted with it all over the country because I was at one point president of the International Crop Improvement Association. And I wanted to get out into the commercial seed business, which I finally did as manager of a wholesale outfit that owned a fertilizer plant as well as a big wholesale seed company. I managed the seed part of it. But the fertilizer industry got us into trouble, and that didn't go too good, but I continued to make money in the seed part of it. But finally I became director of the marketing division of the State Board of Agriculture, a job that wasn't as challenging as I'd like for it to have been. One day, a couple of guys from Oklahoma A&M called me and said, "Russell, would you like to take over the farm broadcasting for WKY Radio and Television?" And I said, "They've asked us to find them a man, and there's only two of you that we're considering, and you're the top man." "Well," I said, "I don't know." "Well," I said, "it'll pay pretty good." So I said, "Well, okay, I'll take a look at it." So I went up and talked to the manager of WKY Radio and Television and to his two assistants. And I said, "Well, it's interesting. I'm not going to give you an answer right now, but I would like to have an answer from you if, because I'd already started my own seed production." I said, "I'm in the seed business, and I want to continue it because it's doing pretty good. Do you have any objection to my continuing to grow certified seed?" "No, no," they said, "the more of that you do, the better job you're going to do of broadcasting because you'll know what the problems are." So I said, "Okay, next question. Do you mind if I go down and talk to Ed Gaylord?" Gaylord owned a publishing company and WKY Radio and Television. "No," they said, "we don't care, go ahead." I had heard a rumor that they're going to close out the farm department. I wanted assurance that I wasn't going to get in there and then attend the funeral. So I went down and talked to Ed Gaylord. He said, "Russell, if you want that job, I'll give you this assurance. As long as the Oklahoma Publishing Company owns WKY Radio and TV, there will be a farm department there, and if you do a good job, it'll be yours." So I went back and told the management that I'm going to take it. So, so I did.
What year was this, Russell?
1953.
Okay. So at that time, was it radio and TV or just radio?
Both of them.
Both of them, okay.
I got up at 2:30 every morning, went out and got things ready for radio, put it on, but did part of it live, and the rest of it on tape, and then run over to the other building where television was and did the 7 o'clock broadcast on television.
Let me back up and ask you a couple questions. So you continued to farm your seed business. Did you own a farm where you were raising your seeds?
Yeah, well, it was contract. I guess I owned some land, but I needed irrigated land, so I made contracts with farmers that had irrigated, and I supplied the parent stock, which I developed myself.
Where were your farms located?
Most of the contract farms, the people I contracted with, was in Jackson and Greer counties. Had some over in Harmon County.
And near where you grew up? It says near where you grew up there in
South. Yeah, near where I grew up.
Mm-hmm. Well, Russell, let me ask you a quick question. And I mean this in a positive sense, what had you done that you felt prepared you for this kind of job? And this was sort of a change, wasn't it, for what you normally did? But did you have some media experience?
Well, I'd been a guest on radio and TV repeatedly.
So you weren't intimidated by being behind the camera and being on TV?
Well, I wasn't camera shy, no. Because I'd been on so much. And when I went there, they told me, the program director said, "Now, I want you to close each one of these programs that you do on television with a safety thought." I said, "We've been doing that for quite a long while." I said, "Okay." So I did. It was just a verbal thing. And I thought, gee whiz, how boring can things be? So I said, I asked the program director, "Would you mind if I put this stuff in rhyme?" Well, they said, "No, not if you think you can keep it up. Wouldn't want you to start it if you can't continue it." Well, I said, "I think I can handle it." So from there on, for 20 years, every broadcast day had a new rhyme. It made a little two-line or four-line rhyme that had a meaning of some kind to it. And I honestly, some of them were humorous, some of them were religious, spiritual. They usually applied to some program of some item of the day. Occasionally it was politics. Now you'd be surprised how much you can get by with in goosing, jabbing a politician if you put it in rhyme. So I wasn't vicious with it, but made it a little bit amusing. So I did that. Never used the same poem twice.
Over how many years?
Oh, a little better than 20.
And come up with a new rhyme every day?
Every day, Monday through Friday, sometimes on Saturday.
Well, can you give me an example of some of your favorite rhymes that you remember?
I don't memorize them. I usually carry one or two in my pocket, but that'll use too much of your film, me trying to get it out of my pocket.
I tell you, you still got it in your pocket?
I got it in my hip pocket.
Go right ahead and pull it out.
Hip pocket's not hard to get it out of. I should have anticipated that you'd be asking something like this.
So while you're looking at this, that's okay, I'll be talking. So for all those years, 5-6 days a week, you come up with a new rhyme, yeah. Never the same rhyme. How did you do that?
Well, the newspaper helps. Mm-hmm. You know what the topics of the day are, what things are of interest.
Kind of like Will Rogers used to do?
Well, don't class me as Will Rogers. He was something extra. Here's one I carry in my pocket all the time. Because, you know, the thing that people remember most about my broadcasts were these little rhymes.
It's your signature feature.
Yeah, because it's always right at the end of the broadcast. "Have you hitched your wagon to a star? You'd better know the star you pick. Sometimes these worldly stars repay with a most unpleasant kick. But there's one star of brilliant light, a truly precious gem. You're safe to hitch your wagon to the Star of Bethlehem." I carry that one with me all the time.
Great. Good story. Well, Russell, let me come back and ask you, to someone that might not have heard of your broadcast, can you kind of describe what your typical format was like and what you talked about in your programs when you gave your report?
Well, we always started out with the markets. Because that took up quite a bit of the time. I made a deal with the major auction markets around over the state, as well as the Oklahoma City market, to provide me with a broadcast, with a call, phoned in report of how their market went that day. And each day I had the Oklahoma City market and one of the auction markets out in the state, like Ringling, Enid, Pawhuska, Oh, Chickasha, if Chickasha was a good one. Tonkawa. Altus. Those are some of them.
Just kind of covered the state. So you'd give the commodity reports what the prices were, what
they were selling? Yeah, we'd go tell them what the prices were, how big the runs were at the market, how many head they had. Mm-hmm. It was mostly cattle. Oklahoma City reported the hog market too. But most of the out in the state markets were just strictly cattle. And they'd tell us how many they had in the auction and what the prices ranged from different classifications of cattle. But we had a good audience.
In addition to giving the report, did you have a talk about certain industries or markets a little
bit? And of course, there was on Associated Press and on United Press, The Wire, there was always some agricultural news of national importance, and we reported that. And other events of agricultural importance around Oklahoma, we would report them. It was interesting. As far as I was concerned, there never was a boring day.
How long was your program?
30 minutes.
30 minutes. And was it in the around noontime or when?
We just did the markets at noon, that's all. Wouldn't take but 2 or 3 minutes to do a market price at noon. But our morning program on TV was 30 minutes, and on radio we had it broken into 6 different segments, which were anywhere from 1 to 2 minutes.
And so you're in your TV program in the morning, what time did it air?
On TV?
Yes, sir.
7 o'clock. Okay. I went on radio at 5:30.
Wow, so you said earlier you got up, what?
5:30 to 6 o'clock, maybe 6:30 sometimes, that was live, and then the rest of it was on tape. But I had to be over at that TV show and get that makeup on my face and all that stuff before the program started at 7 o'clock.
What time did you have to get up each morning?
2:30.
2:30.
But it wasn't bad, you got used to it.
What time did you go to bed?
Anywhere from sundown to sometimes midnight.
Oh, wow.
Because I went out and had an occasional speaking engagement at a banquet somewhere that I had up here.
You're pretty popular on the speaking circuit, as I recall.
No, not much. That was not one of my big deals.
You talked about Ed Gaylord. Earlier, did you develop over the years a relationship with Mr. Gaylord?
Yeah, Ed and I were on a first name basis. We had either by accident or by intent. He had a lot of investment, and I had a meager investment in the same company, and that's where we first got acquainted. He put a lot of money in with some other people. And I put a little money in, and that's where our acquaintance started.
What do you remember about Mr. Gaylord?
What?
What do you remember most about Mr. Gaylord?
I remember that you could depend on what he said, and he didn't mind speaking his piece. And Mr. Gaylord, E.K. Gaylord, his dad, was the same way. I had great respect for Ed's dad, who lived to be 102, maybe it was 101.
Were there some other professional activities you're engaging in at this time during all those years, other things in the business you were doing?
Well, while I was on, and this wasn't really a business, while I was on radio and TV, and I started this year, I was president of the National Association of Radio and Television Broadcasters. We decided we need a little money there in the National Association, so one of the guy's wife was in a travel agency, and we started taking tours, either foreign tours or cruises, and our broadcasters would get people together from states around the U.S. And I did it for several years on radio and TV, to the point that I have been on every continent on this planet except Antarctica. I never got down there and didn't want to go there, but I've been to all the other continents.
Switching gears just a little bit, could you talk a little bit about your family? You know, you had a couple of daughters, and you and Bernice. Could you talk a little bit about your family life?
Well, as I think I mentioned earlier in the show, there was a blue-eyed blonde at that place where I had lunch when I was working out on the experiment station in the summertime. We ran for Aggie Princess, Aggie Queen, and we won. And the romance took off after that. And we had 3 years of romance, and then got married, as I mentioned before. The Lord was good to us and gave us a daughter after a couple of years. And then 6 years later, along came another little blonde. The first girl was a brunette. She took after me, although my hair is not brunette anymore. The other was blonde. Mm-hmm. Both of them became school teachers. Lanice majored in physical education up at Oklahoma State, and she became a physical education teacher. Served, I don't know, 15, 16 years out at Harrow, Oklahoma. And when she retired, they named the gymnasium after her. It is now the Lanice Craft Gymnasium. The other one started out as an elementary teacher after having graduated up at Oklahoma State University, as did her husband, Bob Schuller. And she finally became a superintendent here in Oklahoma. And then one outfit out in Colorado wanted her in the San Luis Valley. She went out there for 2 or 3 years and then came back home and was superintendent out at Hinton. And then she finally retired. This is the blonde, the second daughter.
Your second daughter that retired after being superintendent at several schools?
Yes, that's Patricia Gale Choler. She started out as an elementary teacher and then finally became a superintendent here in Oklahoma, down in southeastern Oklahoma, and then a school out in the San Luis Valley of Colorado made a good deal for her, and she went out there for 2 or 3 years, but she wanted to come back home, so she came back and was superintendent out of Hinton. No, the town south of Hinton. Doggone it. Those people out there will hate me for forgetting the name.
It'll come to you, man. Don't worry about it.
Anyway, she finally retired and thought she was retired, but the state superintendent of schools called her and said, I need you. So she became assistant state superintendent of schools and stayed with that for 2 or 3 years, but she didn't like the politics of it. So she retired again. And Oklahoma schools just kept after her until she went to an elementary school down in southeastern Oklahoma and started teaching. And she's now principal of it, but she says, this is the last year, I'm going to retire again.
Now, one of your daughters recently won a contest.
Well, yes.
You care about that?
That's my oldest daughter, Lanice Kraft. Lanice, and I talked her into it. I got a piece of mail addressed to my deceased wife about the senior Mrs. Oklahoma pageant. It was just an ordinary publicity piece. So I told both the girls, I said, "No, y'all ought to enter that. You may not win, but it'd be a good experience for you." No, Pat said, "No, I'm too busy." Well, Lanice finally decided that she would go ahead and participate in the senior Mrs. Oklahoma pageant, which she did, and which she won. So she'll be representing Oklahoma in the Mrs. Senior America pageant in Maryland, Atlantic City, Maryland, New Jersey rather, Atlantic City, New Jersey, first week of October. And her daddy is going to go along as the supervisor.
The chaperone.
Chaperone, yeah. As will some other people. We will have six or eight people there from Oklahoma.
We're kind of full circle then, since you had teenage daughters, now you come back chaperoning.
Yeah.
Russell, as you look back on your 21 years career in broadcasting, when you look back on your career in broadcasting, are there some highlights that you remember, certain events, certain things that were stand out in your mind?
Well, I don't know how you'd put it. Being elected president of the National Association, I guess you'd call that one of the highlights.
Yeah, it was National Association and, of Broadcasters.
I got acquainted with a lot of fine people around Oklahoma. That ought to be the highlight, because Oklahoma's made up of excellent people who, many of them have come up the hard way. So they know what it means to have difficulties and successes. Some of the other highlights would have to be these tours and cruises that I took people on. At one time, on one of the cruises, we had 256 people from Oklahoma. It was promoted on both the WKY Radio and Television and Wayne Lyles, who was the farm broadcaster over at Channel 9, also broadcast and got people to go on the tour. But we usually have 150 or so on a tour.
What about you? You had a special honor from the National Radio and Television Farm Broadcasters. You were inducted into their Hall of Fame, is that right?
Yeah.
Was that pretty special for you?
I think they ran out anybody to re-elect. But I did appreciate it.
So you served as president of the National Association of
yes, I served
Radio and Television Farm
Broadcasters. I served all the way up. You start out as second vice president, and then vice president, and then president.
And so those must have been two pretty significant events in your life for you.
Yeah, that's right. It was important event.
Well, Russell, could you share a little bit, since you left, you know, retired from broadcasting, you didn't retire from life. You've been very active and busy.
Well,
can you share some of your activities since you left WKY?
Well, after I left broadcasting, of course, I spent a lot of time here at the fairgrounds. First with my own business, and then as supervisor of the feed and bedding services. And I don't really know what you're wanting there.
Just right there, can you share a little bit? A lot of people wouldn't understand, for the state fairgrounds here, what it means to be in charge of the
well,
and bedding services. What do you do?
the state fair and similar events, which will have to include the world's largest junior livestock show, which is the Oklahoma Junior Livestock Show, which is now called the Oklahoma Youth Expo. Those are very influential in developing young people that may go into agriculture or they may go into industry or into a profession. We've had them go into, but they get some of the basics of life when they compete in an event like the state fair or the junior livestock show. And frankly, I readily admit that the achievement of the people that I have coached in those events, the young people, have been accountable for some of the progress that I've personally made in life, if I've made progress. Frankly, their winnings brought attention to me because I was the coach.
And you also, when you provided the bedding and feed service, you're taking care of all the animals in one of these events. You're taking care of all the feed for them and their straw and the hay, is that
well,
right?
Well, the feed and bedding service that I supervise, and in which Steve Corbin does most of the actual work, I've got to the point I lose my train of thought.
We're talking about the seed and bedding and kind of what, how
big. Oh yeah, what we do. Well, I do most of the buying because I've had a lot of buying experience in past events that I've handled. I do most of the buying of the livestock feed and bagged feed and hay and the bedding, which is part of it is straw, but most of it is wood shavings. And the best deals on wood shavings come out of Canada. So I do a lot of dealing in Canada. One of our main suppliers of bedding is here in Oklahoma, the Xylo Corporation, headquartered at Wayne, Oklahoma. The bagged feed we buy from mostly what used to be the Superior Mills is now owned by another corporation. They are the supplier to old Superior Mills and Purina Mills. Those are the two main bagged feeds that we handle.
And this is big business. I mean,
it is big business. We buy in semi-loads. Of course, now some of things like wheat straw, we generally get that in bobtail loads of 260 bales on a bobtail truck. But the shavings all comes in on 53-foot semi-loads.
And Russell, you provide contract services for the fair, and you're still in charge of this today.
I guess for good reason. By the time when the state fair took over the vendorship themselves, my age was such that insurance would have been prohibitive.
Well, and you're still doing it. I mean, which is amazing. You come to the office and work every day.
Yeah. If there's anything going on, why, I need to be there. Even though Steve Corbin's going to do most of the work, I still need to be there.
Russell, two questions. But if I can, I want to back up for a minute. I meant to ask you when we were talking about with WKY and your broadcasting, what was important to you when you were broadcasting? I mean, what did you think about the most? You're talking to these tens of thousands of people out there. What standards did you hold yourself to as a broadcaster?
Well, first of all, you've got to be truthful. And secondly, you've got to speak in terms that they understand. Some of these technical terms would be a little bit out of range for some people, not because of their intelligence, because they got more of that probably than I have, more intelligence, but just haven't been exposed to certain terms. So you have to keep your conversation on the air in terms that people can readily understand. And sometimes they're not listening too closely, so you want it to be such that that if they only catch part of it, well, it'll be of help to them.
What was most important to you when you were broadcasting? When you were saying what you were saying, doing? What did you keep most in your mind, foremost in your mind?
Well, I want to make a good Christian impression on people without going overboard on it. And I want to speak distinctly so that they can understand what I say. And speak slowly enough that each word is understandable.
How important into people's lives was that what you were doing, the information you were broadcasting, how important was that to these people's lives?
Well, it's very, very important because as from an economic standpoint, we tried to keep them up to date on what things were and what laws were that affected them and that sort of thing. And we tried to keep everything clean rather than trying to be funny. Mm-hmm.
And people were making important decisions based on some of the information you were giving them, weren't they?
Well, yeah, of course they did, especially on the markets and on what prospects were for legislation. Those were quite important to them, and we tried to keep them as informed as we could with our ability.
You talked to him about possible pending legislation at the federal and state level, trends nationally and things like that?
All the way, and sometimes what foreign developments were.
International markets and how that affect prices, et cetera.
Yeah, if it looked like some country is going to cut us off on imports, why, the farmer didn't know that.
So this had to be a responsibility you took pretty seriously then.
Well, you betcha, you better take it serious, because you're affecting lives.
Great. Did you, not in a smug way, but did you feel good about being able to give that kind of information to help people improve their lives and to make good decisions? Was that important to you?
Well, let me put it this way. If you've done your best, you don't go to bed with a guilty conscience. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Good answer. Thanks, Russell. Let me fast forward back to the fair. Can I just want to ask your feelings about the state fair? How has the state fair changed over the years since you've been, you know, for gosh, all your life you've been probably associated with it, but particularly in your contract relationship, how's it changed?
I can answer that in one word: tremendously. Because my first participation in the state fair was out at when the fair was back over on Eastern, the east part of Oklahoma City, and I was county extension agent, and we always brought a truckload of hogs up here to show. And we always brought a hammer and nails along with us because we had to rebuild those pens to keep the hogs in. But when the state fair or the city of Oklahoma City, and I'm not sure who really the instigator was, when they got their eye on this nursery down here, which was southeast of the business part of Oklahoma City, and was able to start building some buildings. That's when the fair began to really make progress. And then, of course, when we got to attracting horse shows, and became known as the world's leading horse show capital, and it was true, as well as was the world's largest junior livestock show, which was held in the spring here. And then when this motel hotel tax went on, and was assigned to, for the benefit of the fair operation. That really set us off in good shape. So the fair has made progress and is still making progress. That building in which my office is, it may be here a year from now, maybe here 2 years from now, but eventually it's going to be another brand new building when the tax money comes in.
Russell, let me ask you this question. In your opinion, are state fairs as important to people today as they used to be in the past?
Well, the answer to that is yes and no. One place that the state fair is not as important to people as it used to be, especially when we were back on the east side of town there, and we had big farm machinery shows. We don't have that anymore, not big ones like that. But the farm show that's held at other times in the year, there's a big farm show held here on the fairgrounds. This is the place for it. It's really important to farmers. Come see what new machinery there is. And insecticides and everything else that is involved in farming.
Russell, changing a little bit back to the OSU, you're pretty special at Oklahoma State University. You're inducted in the Alumni Hall of Fame.
What's that?
I said you're pretty special at Oklahoma State University.
How'd that happen?
Well, you've remained closely connected to OSU throughout your career and throughout your life. Can you talk about some of your experiences with the university and with the Alumni Association through the years? Some of the things you've done with the university and with the Alumni Association?
There's one word there of yours I'm not getting.
Okay. You stayed tied to Oklahoma State University. You've been important to our university. What kinds of activities have you participated in with OSU?
Well, I have attended many of the county extension meetings, and I haven't been to one in the last 3 or 4 years that they have at OSU, but I've always kept up contact with the field crops department, the agronomy department, with the publicity department, and have been on a first name basis with most of the deans of agriculture that we've had up until the last couple of years, which I have not been. Well, you know, I've been riding what I like to call my aluminum horse, and that restricts my activity in some events because I am totally unable to walk without the help of that instrument.
I looked earlier, but you received numerous awards from Oklahoma State University in recognition, induction into the Alumni Hall of Fame. You were a distinguished agriculture alumnus in 1998.
That is a big thrill.
Mm-hmm. Well, are these been pretty special to you?
You bet. Those things are very special to me. And I try not to brag about it, but I do anytime I'm in a meeting where I'm expected to speak. I carry along one of those little summaries of the highlights of my activities and let the master of ceremonies use whatever he wishes to use in introducing me.
And it always has those two awards on it, doesn't it?
Huh?
So you always list those two awards on that recognition piece?
Oh, you bet. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You bet.
There's a general kind of question, but you're going to be 99 this December, is that correct?
That's correct.
Still getting around. What do you attribute your long, successful life to?
As an old farm kid, I got a good start in life, with plenty of exercise, with a hoe, and a cotton track, and driving a team to all kinds of farm implements, because horsepower and mule power was the main power when I was a kid. There were a few tractors around, but not many. Furthermore, I think my high school experience was very valuable, because I, as a member of the male quartet, I was quite frequently called on to appear before crowds. And of course, being an athlete, I was out in front of them. And but A&M, I was very active in the Aggie Society, and another society that not of too good repute, known as the Roughnecks. They were a pep organization. They had two pep organizations at Oklahoma A&M, Oklahoma State University, the Roughnecks and the Hellhounds. Well, I didn't like that name of Hellhound, because that didn't go along with Baptist very well. So I joined the Roughnecks. And as a pledge, they beat the tar out of you, but we took it. We couldn't shave for, I don't know, 6 or 8 weeks. That's part of the initiation. But I was in organizations of that type on the campus.
How important has your Christian faith been to you?
Major. Probably more than anything else in life. Because there's only one ruler. That's the Son of God, Jesus Christ. He's got to be the ruler of your life. Or you have wasted your life. So I've tried to live by the Ten Commandments, as all other individuals have experienced. I have not been totally successful, because we're all sinners. And by the grace of God, we can enjoy eternal life if we put our trust in Jesus.
You've been a deacon for many years, I think, at your church, is that right?
What?
You've been a deacon in your church for many years?
I became a deacon in 1941. I was a young deacon. Oh, I guess I was, what, low 30s, something like that, down in Paul's Valley. And incidentally, though, I never had a lesson in music at any time. I cannot read a note of music. For a couple of years, I led the singing in the First Baptist Church at Paul's Valley.
You told me when you were in the quartet, what were you, tenor, bass?
Oh, no, I was bass.
Bass.
I was the low bass. My voice was even lower then than it is now.
What were some of your favorite songs?
I did some solos.
Did you have some favorite songs?
Yeah, basic songs where you went way down.
What were some of you?
One of my favorite was Asleep in the Deep, which was an ocean song.
In your opinion, Russell, how's OSU changed over the years? You saw it in 1929, we're now in 2010. How in your mind fundamentally has it changed?
Well, what's the difference between a pygmy horse and a draft horse? That's about the difference. Oklahoma A&M was small compared to what it is now. I remember it must have been my junior year, could have been senior. Our enrollment hit just a touch over 3,000. Boy, we thought we had blown the lid off. Now what is it?
21,000,
22,000, 23,000. Yeah. But in facilities, Oklahoma State University is, it is so very, very much bigger than Oklahoma A&M was when I went to school, started school there. And we've got more facilities out in the state than we had. We have spread the dispensing of knowledge to a lot more places.
Russell, has that been important to you as a farm broadcaster and being in agriculture all your life? You know, the experiment station, the county extension offices, the outreach of the land-grant university, is that important to the state?
Well, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You bet your life it is. It's very important. And it was important to us in broadcasting, too, because a lot of our good stories originated there. We had one program that we carried for several years that, had it not been for the Extension Service, the program would not have been. That's what we call the Farmer Rancher of the Month. Every month we went out and did a story on the farm with a farmer and his wife, and usually had the presentation of the award at a civic club meeting there at the hometown for the folks. But the Extension Service and Farm Bureau and Farmers Union, which was called at that time, they were the source of most of the programs that we did on the Farmer Rancher of the Month. So they were really, Extension Service was very important to us in broadcasting.
Did you ever go to Stillwater and work with them there on campus and some of their
occasionally,
ag broadcasting?
Occasionally, but not too often. Mostly they came out in the country. Well, when we did the Farmer Rancher of the Month, it was always nearly always someone from the radio TV section of OSU that was with us.
Well, you've alluded maybe to some of this, Russell, but what do you think have been OSU's strengths as a university through the years?
What about
the what have been the strengths of Oklahoma State strength? University? What things have...
They have carried... It's too much to enumerate. They have, as far as farmers are concerned, they have carried knowledge out there and put it to where in such terms that the farmer could handle it. And they've done that with very oftentimes with the cooperation of industry, chemical companies, fertilizer companies, engineering companies. Yeah. Extension Services, their fingers have reached very far.
Have you been on campus recently?
What?
Have you been on campus recently? Have you seen any
of
their buildings?
I couldn't tell you when the last time was I was up there. The last time I distinctly remember being there was when Burns Hargis invited me and a guest to be his guest at a football game.
Oh, great.
Up there in his suite. I've been there at other times too, but...
What kind of job do you think Burns is doing?
Well, I think he's right down to earth. Mm. You bet. I think he's a good man. And he's got industry experience, financial industry particularly, that can be very beneficial to OSU.
Russell, over the years, you've like you said, you've known most of the deans of the College of Agriculture, probably a lot of the presidents, or some of the university administrators, presidents, deans, others that have stood out in your mind that you think have been important and made contributions to Oklahoma State University and to the state. There's some names that come out to you, jump out to you.
Well, I'm going to put it this way. With the exception of a very, very few, they've all been very important to OSU. We've had good deans of agriculture. We've had good deans of engineering, though I have not been acquainted with the engineering deans very well. Dean McElroy, I think, has been a wonderful influence on OSU.
And he helped get the College of Veterinary Medicine started, didn't he? D. McElroy helped get the College of Veterinary Medicine started, too.
Yes, you bet. That's been a great asset to Oklahoma, that Vet Medicine College has been. Though I have not been well acquainted with the individuals who've headed it.
Did you know Dr. Wilhelm very well?
Oh, yeah. Oliver Wilhelm, you bet. He always called my wife his little Perry girl, because that was her home. Yeah, Oliver Wilhelm, in addition to being a good dean, he was a doggone good man.
And I
liked Bob Calm, too. Bob's wife and I got real well acquainted, I guess because of banquets that were held in Oklahoma City.
I know
one time she was up there at the head table with the rest of the dignitaries, and I was sitting in the first row just below the head tables, and I could tell she was getting bored to death. So I slipped up to her and said, "Go ahead and yawn, it'll be all right."
Was this Maxine?
Maxine.
That's great. So you made sure those were those Oklahoma County student recruitment banquets that the Alumni Association put on, Merle Rogers and so on. Is that the banquet you're talking about?
Oh, this was a banquet that held down at this, I guess, with the Skirvin Hotel. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember what the occasion was. Mm-hmm. Of course, I went to sort of doggone many of those things.
Yes, sir. Well, Russell, let me ask you, what are you going to do for your 100th birthday?
How's that?
What are you going to do for your 100th birthday? Are you going to do something special?
First of all, I'm going to praise the Lord for being so considerate.
Well, do you have any plans for the next century?
Yeah, I'm going to try to live part of it. Actually, many years ago, I set my goal when Mr. Gaylord died. I set my goal that I was going to live to be 102 years old. And I, actually, with the rate I'm going, I think I might achieve it plus some.
And he was 102 when he died, right?
I believe he's either 101 or 102. I think it's 102.
Mm-hmm. Well, do you have any hobbies, or other interests that you do other than here at the fair, state fair?
Me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I love to work. Honestly, I do. I love to work. I used to have a hobby of running, but when I got to where I couldn't stand up without holding on to something, I quit running.
Good idea. Let me leave you this question. It's a serious question. How do you hope people remember Russell Pierson?
As a good guy that tried to be considerate of other people. As a man that lived by the Golden Rule. And that he knew what eternity meant, either in one place or the other. So you want to be with Christ in eternity.
It's a better alternative, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're talking about your greatest blessing in life. Can you share that?
Well, honestly, Jerry, in addition, other than accepting Jesus as my Savior and the promise of eternal life, I think the greatest blessing was when God called Bernice and me together that September noonday when I came in from the field, experiment station, dirty, sweaty, and perhaps smelly, and found that whole parlor full of girls at that boarding house, and that little blue-eyed blonde attracted my attention. Honestly, I think God had a hand in that. because that started 3 years of romance and 6 or 7 years of very happy married life until God called her home in 2002. And the assurance that we will be together again at some point before too many years. For that, I'm grateful.
Russell, let me close with this. You've also blessed the people of the state of Oklahoma and Oklahoma State University with your life and things you've done, and we're very appreciative for that.